could we have the AB, please?
Is for any brand in today's time, any media brand, is how do you win trust? You know, we have a word in television which is often used and much misused and abused, which is TRPs, television rating points. My belief has always been that there is a need to redefine TRPs. It should stand for trust and respect points. Because the real challenge of our times is not just how do you get television rating points, but how do you win the trust, respect of viewers and readers? And I think sometimes we tend to confuse the notion of trust with popularity. You can be popular, that doesn't necessarily mean you are trustworthy. And I think this, it's an almost intangible, how do you define this notion of trust? Because linked to this notion of trust is another interesting word called credibility. How does a brand build credibility? It cannot be built in a week. It cannot be built overnight. And I think too many of us, be it in any aspect of the media, be it in PR, be it in marketing, advertising, or journalism, tend to believe that we can almost overnight win trust or win credibility. To my mind, this is an incremental process that has to be done step by step. It's almost a torturous process, at the end of which, maybe if you stick to your core values, you can actually reach your destination. So I think the challenge is to be patient, the challenge is to be consistent, and the challenge, to my mind, is to stick to your core values. If you can do that, then I do believe that you can win the trust of your client, you can win the trust of your viewer in our instance, or of your reader. But it's a long haul. It doesn't happen overnight. And I think we must be resistant to the pressures to try and overnight try and build trust. It won't happen. I think it's very clear that social media has created a surround sound which can disorient the best of us. It is a bit like an echo chamber. And when you are in an echo chamber, the sound can almost rattle you. So I think social media has done that. It's become a disruptive influence. It's disrupted the media landscape. And I think the challenge of our times is to understand the nature of the disruption that's taking place rather than being swayed away by it. I wouldn't say embrace it, but certainly start recognizing what social media is all about. Don't allow it to sweep you off the floor, but find ways to engage with social media. I believe today we are in a multimedia world in the truest sense of the word, what I call media 360. And platforms no longer matter. What matters is content, the quality of your content. Even in the PR industry, the quality of the message that you're sending out, to my mind, is critical. It's not enough for you to jazz up the message. What is key is, does your message have an intrinsic value to it? And that is something where I believe you can use all these platforms, including social media, to send out a powerful message that people will soon, over time, begin to trust and begin to feel that this is a message which is worth it. I think what they don't teach you in media schools is ethics. And ethics is something which, you know, ultimately is, again, core to any business. You cannot take shortcuts when it comes to ethics. Ethics cannot be compromised upon. And my belief is ethics is linked to a critical word, which is conscience. I believe brands that have a conscience, brands that have core ethical values, sustain and last much longer than brands which try to take shortcuts and compromise on ethics. To my mind, it's that value of ethical behavior which determines the average brand from a great brand, which really tells the real story. In the case of journalism, I think the core value has to be to stick to facts above all else, to be honest to facts. In the PR world, it has to be, again, in my view, to stick to your core message. To my mind, the core of journalism should always be in the center. The ability to be able to appreciate that there could be two sides to a story. that stories are not always black and white, that there is a color called gray also that exists. And the more complex stories are often found in shades of gray. And the challenge for journalism is to locate the complexity of a story. It's very easy to be caught in these polarities. The challenge, as I keep repeating, is to somewhere or the other have a dialogue. I think journalism should be able to stick to facts, and the opinion should be dialogue based. The opinion should not be forced down someone's throat. The opinion should be should respect the viewer, should respect the reader. Opinions are free. Facts are sacred. We tend to mix facts and opinion almost all the time now in journalism. And that's what's caused this credibility crisis. I think the larger credibility crisis is because the lines have got blurred between fact and opinion, whether it's on television and in some instances even in print. So respect the difference that exists between facts and opinion. Number two, I believe that we must be ready to really look at journalism as something which is beyond television rating points or box office. This is not about popularity contests. This is about, in my view, about having a basic intrinsic respect for information and for knowledge. That's, to my mind, the way in which journalism should move. And thirdly, in my view, journalism must retain a strong ethical core. Journalism cannot be about manipulation. It cannot be about manipulating information or falsifying facts. It should be, at the end of the day, about sticking to a core ethical value, which is truth above all else. To my mind, if you can combine knowledge with truth, you will have empowered your viewer or reader. I think a lot of this is exaggerated at times, to believe that journalists are, constantly being asked to compromise their independence. Yes, there are threats to the newsroom. There are corporate pressures, there are political pressures, there are owner pressures. But let's not also exaggerate them. At the same time, I think it is important to realize that there must be a Chinese wall that must exist between the owner, the corporate, the politician, and the journalist. Newsrooms must, to whatever extent possible, be insulated from these outside pressures. You cannot have what I call supari journalism. You cannot have agenda-driven journalism, which is driven by the interests of the corporate owner or driven by a politician. Journalism at its core, if you are to retain credibility, must be insulated from these pressures. You know, when I started journalism in the late 1980s, to be very honest, to be in PR was looked down upon. There was a sense that PR was someone who was a PR person was constantly manipulating and falsifying facts. The PR person was almost bribing the journalists, was the ecosystem in which I started off in journalism. I believe over time the PR world has evolved. We now talk of corporate communications. The true meaning of PR, I believe, is effective communication. Ultimately, you have to communicate a message. And today, journalists rely on this entire large PR machinery to also get a chance to effectively communicate their message. You need to know two sides of a story, for which you often need the help of people who are in the PR corporate communication world. So I think we need to give the PR corporate communication world the dignity it deserves, the respect it deserves, and we need to see this as a relationship which is not adversarial between the journalist and the PR person, or even that it is based on complete co-option. It should be a healthy, harmonious relationship. And I think an award ceremony like this will encourage PR professionals to ensure that they retain that sense of competitiveness, but also ensure an element of ethical values and a harmony which will only benefit the profession. I want to first of all congratulate Exchange for Media for organizing this event. I want to congratulate all the winners. No one ever can tell me that they don't like to win a prize. So I'm sure all the winners are going to have a great time today. And in a way, this is another moment of the coming of age of the PR industry, the fact that it's being recognized in this manner. And all I can say is have a great evening. Sorry I cannot join you today. But I am confident that the PR industry in this country will go from strength to strength, and that you will in a way be the winners. In particular, will give us a sense of the direction and the road ahead for the PR world.
So we also wish Rajdeep all the best for today and for his coming years. Of course, he set the tone for tonight. We're going to be talking about media in the age of mistrust. There used to be a point in time when, like how Rajdeep said, that the journalists were a little wary of the PR industry, and now I guess the PR industry is a little wary of the journalists. This is what's probably going on right now. And we've got a robust panel talking about the various nuances of media as we experience it today. Risk, reputation, brand building, effective communication. Of course, as far as journalism itself is concerned, the divide which is happening, literally. So I'm going to be calling out the names of our panelists here tonight. Request you all to please come and... these are fancy, nice bar stools for you all. We don't want you to be too comfortable because we want you to come back and party with us here on the floor. All right. With a loud round of applause, may I invite my first panelist on stage, Ms. Pooja Pathak, co-founder and director, Media Mantra. A successful entrepreneur with immense creativity and business acumen, which assists her to undertake diverse roles in life, including being a businesswoman, a lecturer, and a mother of two lovely kids. I think that really kind of requires a loud round of applause to be handling homes and professions. And now we need to be imparting this knowledge to the men folk as well, I guess. Mr. Bhupendra Chaubey, TV journalist since 2000 from NDTV to CNN IBN, has covered three general elections as a political journalist, now hosts a weekend show, Hot Seat, writes for various Hindi and English publications, both online and offline. Thank you, Mr. Chaubey, for taking the time for being here. Ms. Vibha Bakshi, a national award-winning filmmaker, acknowledged by the President of India for the best film on social issues. She's also made films for the United States government and HBO, both of which have been highly acclaimed. Vibha's also studied journalism and broadcasting from the Boston University and New York University. Thank you, Vibha, for taking the time for being here tonight. Our moderator, Kumardeep Banerjee, who heads external communication for Vodafone, looking into stakeholder engagement for reputational brand management. Prior to this, he's been a broadcast journalist with Zee, Aaj Tak, and Bloomberg TV. Thank you. Ex-colleagues, yes. And last but definitely not the least, can we hear a loud round for Mr. Sharif Rangnekar, Chairman Integral PR, a former journalist and researcher. Sharif has led the firm as its CEO for over 10 years and taken over as its chairman in 2015. Amongst other things, of course, we all know Sharif personally, but I don't know how many of us do know he's associated with an initiative, I Am Who I Am, and also a band, Friends of Linger. He sings as well, and he's raising his voice for the LGBT community as far as India is concerned. Can we hear it out loud for Sharif? All yours, 45 minutes, Kumardeep. Please do keep at least 10 minutes for this wonderful audience to pose some questions to you. All yours.
All right. I guess I'm wonderful at the back and I'm working. Is the mic working now? Yep, fine. Thank you, Suparna, for that wonderful sort of an introduction that takes away about 5 minutes from the introduction which I had set out. So very good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for making it through this traffic-filled Delhi evening, which is a common feature in the central part of Delhi. Thank you for all being here. Thank you, Exchange for Media Events. Thank you, Suparna, for getting an eclectic mix of ladies and gentlemen under and putting them under the spotlight this evening to discuss one of the most crucial existential angst that has hit humankind ever since the general elections in one of the most prosperous democracies in the world. Okay. Well, not that dramatic, but yeah. As Rajdeep was mentioning, today we discuss something what Denzel Washington had once said, that if you subscribe to the media, you are uninformed. And if you do not subscribe to the media, you are uninformed. If you do not subscribe to the media, then you are misinformed. So media in the age of mistrust is what we are going to discuss. And we have a whole host of experiences right here under the spotlight. And we carry forward our what we call the bar side chat, because this is not a fireside chat. So we'll go ahead with our bar side chat. And Suparna and rest of you, some of you are far bigger authorities sitting right there at the back on the topic at hand and on the switching of narratives, the shifting of narratives, the shifting media scape, the bipolarity, the polarities in the world that we are seeing right now. So we will have ample time for question and answer. Suparna, please be the timekeeper. If any of us tend to exceed that 45 minutes window, do raise your hand or do throw some of those stuff that you could find near you. So without much ado, quick opening remarks from our fellow panelists. Should I go left? Should I go right? I don't know which one, but let me go with you, Sharif. So Sharif has got some interesting takes on mistrust and media. So let's hear you. Let me put in a question towards your opening remarks. Do you think a good amount of mistrust is actually good for business? Maybe you can tackle it as well.
See, I really don't think mistrust is good for business. Mistrust might be good for certain media houses, I think. You know, to mislead people. And due respect. I think the thing is that we're taking up this topic perhaps a little, it's a good topic to take up, and that too at a PR forum, because invariably the trust aspect, as Rajdeep said, has been questionable when it comes to the PR industry for a long time. And even today, I think there are a lot of journalists who don't trust PR people. But I think the biggest problem is really not in PR, because I think as an industry, we, the clients that we represent, stand for scrutiny. I mean, they are up for scrutiny. We engage directly with the press. We engage with other consumer groups, stakeholders, etc. But I think the story of mistrust of, as far as the press goes back a long way. And I think many of you all would remember an ad campaign from one of the largest newspapers in the world, actually, in English, which compared a newspaper with the price of a newspaper with a samosa. I think at that time itself, the press itself started to relook at itself as what it was. A leading promoter of the same group stands up and compares a newspaper with a fast-moving consumer group, consumer good, which is basically saying it's like a soap, it's like shampoo, etc. So I think the dumbing down of press itself started long ago, and perhaps we didn't notice it, you know. And if we look at even the current situation, as Rajdeep also pointed out, you're seeing a polarization, you know, where certain press believe they're nationalists, certain press believes they're anti-national, or they're being termed anti-national. There are press where, as you just said, should I look left, should I look right? So, you know, that ideology is another problem that the press is facing. So I think the issue for PR is much easier today as far as trust and representing brands, but I think the problem lies really and resides mostly with the press, who today is owned by corporations. And while there might be Chinese walls, but we all know Chinese walls, the Chinese wall is not a wall. And so we don't know where that gray area is perhaps a challenge for us to address, but in terms of credibility, it's for the press to really sort that out.
Well, thank you, Sharif, for those opening remarks. They are pretty cogent. Should I turn to Bhupendra? Do you want to directly take that on, or should I go with the ladies for your opening remarks as well?
Sure. Bhupendra. Am I audible?
I don't think you're audible. Do you want a mic? And this is one of those rare moments when you are being subjected to a moderation and not audible.
Okay, this is fine. No,
firstly, thanks to the organizers of this event. Lovely place, last place to be having an intellectual, intelligent conversation since the bar is right in front.
Yeah, the bar side chat.
Yeah, it's a bar side chat. But since the topic is such, and since Sharif has set up this debate in, frankly, if I may say, so very predictable manner, all points which he's raised are points which have existed before the press for a very long time. And the fact that this debate has been kick-started by a journalist pontificating about what the PR industry is all about also tells us a lot about the times that we live in. So firstly, let's be honest about the reality of the times that we live in. I have a lot of friends in the PR industry. And truth be told, Sharif, over the last 7 to 8 years, some of the best stories that I've done have all come from the PR sector. So huge round of applause. Woo! To all of you. Because I do believe a lot of my colleagues have actually switched over to the PR profession. So I don't buy this theory for a moment that you know, there was a time when PR was being looked down upon and journalists were these great souls and PR people were, you know, were somewhere there. I don't buy that at all. And that's one of the reasons why I'm here. What I do believe, where this word mistrust has kind of got embedded with our industry, and I'm even willing to say that this is a huge opportunity before India as of today, where PR and press can frankly both coexist and cooperate with each other. I do not see anything wrong whatsoever with a representative from the PR fraternity coming to me and telling me about a story which, let's say, may be helping a certain client of his or may be against a certain client of an adversary, as long as the story is factual. As long as there is some merit and some depth, if it is backed by facts, if it's backed by documents, I'll go with the story. My job is not to look after your client's interests or the interests of someone's adversaries. My job is to bring the information out. Now, if to that extent, if the press will be called compromise, if the press will be called taking sides, then so be it. Our job is to bring out facts. Our job is to bring out a story. On the question of Chinese walls, on the question of corporate ownership, I've just turned 40 this year. And I have been around now for what? I started working with NDTV with my dear friend Shivraj sitting right there many, many years back. Since the time I started working as a professional journalist till now, and even before when one would be hearing about the press and about the media, all these questions have been raised. If the allegation is that the press is compromised today, let me say press was always compromised. If the allegation is press has no credibility, let me say press has never had any credibility whatsoever. Having said all that, I think there is still enough scope, despite the restrictions, despite the pressures which Rajdeep very lucidly has pointed out, which are applicable in all of us. I think there is still scope, there is still opportunity in which all of us can discharge our responsibilities. And as much as I salute and compliment my friends and colleagues in the PR industry, similarly, I compliment all my friends and colleagues in the journalism space who, despite those pulls and pressure, still manage to put up some kind of a reasonable product out there night after night. This challenge of whether you're right, whether you're left, what's your ideology, I face this challenge on a daily basis. Just 48 hours back, I'm looking at a scenario where a political party has sued us for supposedly towing the line of a party B, and the party B 24 hours later sues us for supposedly towing the line of party A. Now, if both these parties are upset and both these parties are going to accuse us of taking their side, then I think that we're doing something right, because our job is to ensure that both party A and party B are equally upset with us.
Thank you, Bhupendra. That's an interesting conversation to have, and you have the round of applause to suggest what it means. We will park some of the thoughts that you have raised there, and I'm sure our lovely audience, the informed audience that we have, has some questions. But let me turn to you, Vibha, and you more from a civil society perspective, more from an observer perspective, though you are one of fairly vocal content creator in this space. How do you look at this entire media space? How do you look at the narratives which are being weaved around mistrust through various channels?
First of all, a big thank you to everyone for being here. I've just driven down from Haryana, where we've started the sequel for our film, Daughters of Mother India. But I just want to say that as a documentary filmmaker, I will always be a struggling filmmaker. The issues that we take up are going to be very sensitive. And the last one that we took up was on what happened to India after the night of Nirbhaya's rape and murder. I don't think I could have got into a more sensitive and a volatile zone. And the result has been that besides the National Award, which we are very grateful for, the film got embraced by the government, by the police, by the activists and academia. And I think there was a lesson to learn there, which was that even as a documentary filmmaker, you can create emotions that you have that ability to create emotions. And so you have to be very responsible. When this film came out, there was only one thing that the team said, that we will make a responsible film. And if the intent and emotion is right, your viewer is very smart to understand it. We had gained access to the Delhi Police Control and Command Room, and I could have done whatever I wanted with the police. The quotes that I could have got would be similar to the other film that got released. It would have been sensational. I would have swept the international awards. At one point, I really thought nobody would watch Daughters of Mother India besides our families. But that's not what happened. And that's when I say, you've got to be true to yourself in whatever you do. Your viewers are smart enough to understand that. The film had no solutions. The film had no heroes or villains, and that's what we talk about. It doesn't have to be black or white. Leave it to the audience to derive what they want to out of it. And I think I am an extremely small part of what Unleashed. You need the help, and that's where I bring up the public relations company. We could not have made a small film like Daughters of Mother India movement without Weber Shandwick, which was the PR company that supported us pro bono. And really a big round of applause to them, because we could not have done this alone. And that's when I appeal to everybody, that those who are in the position of power and influence, then do it the right way. Use it when you need to, because that's far more important than just branding.
Thank you, Vibha. That was very interesting, because you alluded to what Rajdeep was saying. Facts are sacred, and if you have the right kind of intent, then facts are what it matters. But let me turn my attention to Pooja. You are a career communicator, as well as a mother of three, though Suparna said mother of two. Having said that,
God is the company.
Okay, we will not create mistrust here. So tell us, how does one manage reputation? What are the reputational risks and reputational management risks in an era of mistrust, something which you are passionate about?
A very good evening to all of you present here. I think today's discussion is something which is very alarming, and it is something which is very crucial considering the point of time and the point of hour that we are today in. There's no silver bullet solution to deal with this kind of a situation. But the only thing that has to be done in today's epoch of mistrust is that we need to prioritize our integrity, and we need to start respecting our values. That's the first thing that we need to do as responsible individuals, and that's the first thing we need to do as responsible professionals. Not just that, the issue of mistrust is not in one industry. It is seen across the verticals, and it is seen across the sectors. You take the recent example of Tata and Cyrus. That's a clear-cut case of corporate mistrust. We take the example of surgical strikes. That's a case where we are today questioning our own army officers. This is completely uncalled for, and this is something which we have never done in so many years. I personally believe that the times of communication that we are today in, we can have insurance claim for everything, but we cannot have an insurance claim for reputation. So it is therefore important to handle reputation with a lot of care and with a lot of caution.
Thank you, Pooja. Well said, well said. And there you have the teams clapping for you. Let me turn a quick question to Bhupendra. Sorry. So there are these echo chambers which exist, and we are somehow tired, we are part of the process, we are somehow drawn into it. What Rajdeep was alluding to as surround sound of media. Do you think that it's the birth of these echo chambers which is keeping away the real narrative from emerging in front of the audiences?
Actually, what is a real narrative? Let me put that question on the table. What is reality? What you describe as an echo chamber, what a lot of people around us describe is a platform which thrives on anonymity, which thrives where reputations are assassinated on a daily basis, if not an hourly basis. For many, that's the reality. For many, the reality that we attempt to dish out on a daily basis on our news platforms is not the reality. It's a skewed version of a reality. So it depends on which side of the table you are really on. I think what has really happened and why you're having this debate and why you're using this word mistrust is because somewhere along the line, maybe because of the kind of spectacular growth that social media platforms have seen, maybe the fact that increasingly news increasingly gets broken on Twitter or Facebook, and more often than not, when it breaks on a social media platform, it turns out to be false. But because there are no checks and balances as such, you know, you want to say something about me, you can go, you can tag 20 people, you can say whatever you want to say about me. I want to say something about you, you know, and let me just say this, that while I applaud and compliment my friends in the PR fraternity, manipulation of social media, manipulation of perceptions, as many of you would certainly know, itself has turned out to be a huge industry. I mean, you know, I don't want to take names here, but let me just say this, that some friends of mine, they actually showed me how Twitter trends can actually be manipulated. Now, someone is doing that, boss. You know, there are professional teams out there which are manipulating perceptions, something that I'm describing as perception. As I said, to many, that's a reality. And they say that what we dish out is a perception. If I fall for that, then that's where my fault is. And I think that's where also the distinction between the so-called mainstream media and the so-called social media really comes in. The new forms of media really comes in. Because at the end of the day, I think there is still some filters. They've been compromised, they've come down, quality may have come down. I'm always the first one to admit that, but I think it's still much better in comparison to where we are as far as social media platforms is concerned. And I think it will take some time, you know, before both these really come together. So this word mistrust will forever remain embedded with our industry, with our profession, till such time there is no equality of sorts between what is new age media and what is so-called old world conventional media.
Thank you, Bhupendra. Very interesting. I would like you to think upon one interesting bit. Has the world really changed post the general elections in US, when we saw these echo chambers leading to what they did in a way? But we'll park that thought. But let me turn to Sharif and perhaps Pooja and Vibha also. Do you think it's the echo chambers as the social media is turning out to be, which is the real culprit for this mistrust? Or do you think there is a more manipulative agenda at play? And if the social media weren't there, there would have been something else.
See, I think Bhupendra is right. I mean, there's perhaps a lot more manipulation that takes place because a lot of what flows around in social media is also word of mouth. And then if Bhupendra is my friend and he posts something, I trust him. I might repost it, but I may not verify what he's posted. And a lot of that happens. But I think, manipulation, just like he said, this whole issue of credibility in the press or credibility of PR, they've been consistently perhaps questionable for a long time. But I think the manipulation seems to be part of a certain kind of culture that we also live in, just like was being seen, the times that we're living in. And because when you have ideologies also impacting, and I think it was, if I remember, Madan also, Madan Behel of Ad Factors had tweeted when the US results came. And he made a tweet which had something to do with you know, that the press in the US should have put its ideologies aside and reported the news or what was happening. And I think, so when you're looking at manipulation, it's not just in the US, but it's been happening here as well. When a large corporation that has also been, the name was mentioned, pulls out an ad campaign or pulls out all of its ads from a newspaper and uses that as a tool to determine what stories also come, that's also manipulation. And that goes back a long time, so it's not today.
Can I just add, and can I really be blunt with this? I think the word mistrust is being debated here in this manner simply because of there's one simple perception and there's one simple thought, and I just want to put it very, very clearly. By the day, I'm getting more and more convinced that hatred in our society is getting institutionalized. Yeah. We love to hate each other. We don't love to love each other anymore. And that's why we love it. If I could be distrustful towards you, if I could find a reason to hate you, it'll keep me going.
Absolutely.
And it's a very sad thought.
I just want to add something, please, because this whole thing of hate, and without referring to which television program we're talking about.
This is not television.
No, I'm just saying.
This has got nothing to do with TV or politics. It's the times we live in.
We were sitting in an ad agency, right. One of the largest ad agencies, and they were debating this primetime TV news thing. And they said that most of the people watch it because they wanted to know, ab wo kiska lega? Hatred.
Thank you. Sharif, thank you for that. But this entire concept of politics of hatred and the politics of the counter-narrative is something which we should ask Viva about, because some of the issues she deals with are on the politics of hatred. So do you think by any chance these echo chambers are helping in creating a positive narrative, or they are creating to what you call the era of mistrust?
First of all, films like us, it's very hard to get people to watch it, first of all. So when people watch our films, we are very, very grateful. So what a lot of people do, what you're talking about, mistrust, I think in the world of documentary films, we won't call it mistrust, we'll call it sensationalism, right? So if you, rather than handling a subject sensitively, if you sensationalize it, you just feel you're going to get more attention on it. And we've seen that. We've seen that happen again and again, even the way India is portrayed internationally. I mean, I remember when I went to New York for the festival, there was that time when India had got the reputation of being the rape capital of the world. And I remember I was walking with a group of Indians, and everybody was looking at the Indian males as potential rapists. And I was like, this is what can happen. This is called sensationalism. Now, since I had made a lot of films for HBO in New York, which dealt with sensitive issues, I looked at the audience and said, what if I filmed a white cop who's killed a black cop and said, that bastard deserved to die? Is the entire United States racist? And there was pin drop silence. And I said, with that, we will open the film called Daughters of Mother India, and please look at it from a balanced perspective. So I think, again, in our world, you sensationalize it, it's very cheap publicity, which will last very short while.
Sensationalism is something which Pooja would discuss on the reputational management bit. So do you think, again, I'm getting back to the question I put to Sharif there. Do you think a little bit of mistrust means good business? And I gave it a thought before asking. I repeat that question.
So, in my opinion, I feel that individuals today are the agents of change. They are the influencing community today. Having said that, it means that today the strings of effective communication are with the individuals today. Also, there is, when we talk about business, mistrust, and reputation, it is not reputation risk management. It is risk to reputation which needs to be managed. And that is a bigger question. When it comes to mistrust in the era of this, in current scenario, I feel we are still a thin layer away from creating an era of distrust, which is going to be even more alarming. So I think it's better that we wake up now.
Thank you. And for the sake of time, and my timekeeper is showing me
those the watch. So what I will do is we will take a couple of quick, sharp questions from our audience. Please raise your hands. There will be our teammates who would go across around the table and put across the mic.
Okay, Katie, before you actually throw the floor open, can we have like a last word of what do we do in the existential situation? What is the solution? We've all spoken about what the, you know, what the problem is as far as mistrust is concerned, as far as journalism is concerned, as far as manipulating things are concerned and sensationalizing. Where can we actively, with along with the PR fraternity, along with the journalists, along with the entire media industry, how do we approach this? If everyone individually, of course, wants to kind of, you know, portray a certain kind of a thing, but what finally is getting done is a representative of what you and I are, you know, kind of putting out there.
Yeah, we
be
are...
Be responsible. That's what it is.
Yeah, I mean, I let me try to...
Do one positive trait a day. Think about one positive thing a day.
Yeah,
rather
absolutely.
Than thinking about, you know...
I kind of agree
with... The natural
with
perceptions that we have and the natural things that we do.
And what Rajdeep... Sorry. And what all of us have been trying to hint at is that doing the right thing, yeah. Sticking to the facts, sticking to our ethics, our core ethics, whether you are a communicator, whether you are a public affairs personnel, whether you are a journalist, whether you belong to any part of the world, doing what you think is right and sticking to the facts because they are sacred will help us wade through some of these noises which have been created in the echo chamber. Sharif and Pooja, sorry.
Out of 10 yeah. occasions, if you listen to your heart on 7 occasions, 3 occasions you'll be forced to compromise. No problem. 7 occasions, if you're willing to listen, yeah. you would have changed the world.
Yeah. Yeah, I think you should report with integrity and perceive with intelligence. That's the way forward.
Would you give up business when you know that the corporate doesn't have any ethics?
Would you give up business? I'll talk over drinks.
But many of the, Suparna, actually the many of the corporate PR agencies sitting out there have given up on business, on businesses which they think are not aligned to their corporate ethics.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
Sharif might be adding to that. Please, Sharif, your last word on that.
No, I mean, definitely. I mean, if we find a corporation has certain practices that are not ethical, they're not responsible, they don't believe in being as responsible, citizen, then I think we're going to keep a huge distance from them. And I think I can speak, having been part of PRCAI and during the Neera Radia incident at that time, I think the whole industry came together and stood by certain guidelines which were, you know, developed by the European Public Affairs Commission at that time. And I think that's important because we need to consistently follow that.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Sharif. So, and ladies and gentlemen, please have the questions flowing. Otherwise, what Suparna has been telling me is there will be no drinks flowing. So quickly, some questions, please, if you want some glasses. Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
Hi, I'm Jairam from Aviva. Question more directed towards Mahendra. Of late, if you see the front page of a newspaper or any of the news channels, most of the news that comes out are the kind that she made a documentary on. Now, obviously, they are sensationalist in nature. As an editor, when you decide the layout of a newspaper or when you decide what news should come first, do you consciously think that it is a news that needs to be sensationalized or do you act on your conscience or given to your business pressure saying that, you know, this news will guarantee the front, this news on the front page can actually increase my circulation or TRPs? Yeah.
Thank you, Jairam. We will collect a couple of questions and take them in. Yes, please.
Shivraj.
No. I mean, this is. Let's not make it a shouting match this evening, please.
So, just sure. A follow on from what Suparna asked. You know, in journalism, in communications, we deal with facts. So, at the end of the day, aren't facts sacrosanct? And what is the solution? I mean, clearly, there has to be an alternative. Because if we're going to crib about it, we're not going to get anywhere, right?
So, do you have a question directed towards somebody?
Yep. So, what is the solution? I mean,
right. Anybody can take it.
Yeah, anybody.
Okay, I will take it. Fine, fair enough. Anybody else with questions? Some ladies, do you mind? I mean, if Dr. Kapoor sitting right there at the back, do you have any questions? Mr. Madan Bahl, do you have any questions for any of us? If not, then we will.
So, let me just answer a question which was raised by Jairam.
Sure.
I think. So, you know, actually, Jairam's question just proves what I've always believed in. that we as Indians, and I'm sorry if I offend any one of you, I believe that we are the biggest hypocrites. And I'm convinced, including me, right? We want to say something, we want to see something, we want to do something else. Now, I can give you, you know, so I do this program called Big Five at 10 on a weekly basis. And I'll be very honest to you, I can give you, at this point of time, I can give you 5 stories from across the country, from back and beyond of places that probably many of you may not even have heard of. But you know what will happen? I'll put those stories out. At the end of the day, I'm also, as much as I hate it, but I have no other option right now, so I'm, let's say, subservient to this beast called TRP. My TRP will be 0, right? On the contrary, if I was to pick up a story which you describe as sensationalist, I won't use the word sensationalist, but let me use the word shock. So if there was a story which really shocks you, I'll give you a classic example. A few weeks back, just before the surgical strikes in September, there was a beautiful story which came from Jhabua district of Madhya Pradesh. It's a tribal-dominated district. And the story was of a group of schoolgirls who all came together and who gheared out the office of the district magistrate of that area, because the school that they were going in, that school did not have a pakka road leading up to the school. Funds had been allocated and various ministers had come and gone and nothing had been done for several years. And those girls, imagine that back and beyond of Jhabua, it's one of the poorest districts in the country, they came together for the sake of their own future. I spent a good half hour on that story. We called the district magistrate, got hold of the chief minister, led to some impact. Road was built in like 48 hours time flat. That was a kind of impact, right? So the political class certainly is wary of what comes out on the media. But when I actually looked at the ratings the next week, it was abysmal. So I can do it once, I can do it twice, I can do it thrice. If I keep playing these stories and if I keep seeing, then, you know, so that's it. So 7 times, I let my heart decide. 3 times, I will let the realities of the world that I live in also decide.
Thank you, Bhupendra.
That's great. That number is great.
I kind of agree with Bhupendra, because often in a newsroom, sometimes you would hear this, the boss, Krishi Darshan thodi chalana hai tumhe. And by the way, Krishi Darshan as a program is still on air and it is free to air prime time. But look at let's not get into the TRPs. Coming back to the question, what is sacrosanct, sir?
Shivraj, so second question. Then what is the answer? So my solution is the same, you know, because this dilemma of how do you ensure that you just stick to facts? I would like to say that we should stick to facts 100%, but as I've already stated very bluntly and clearly, that if you listen to your heart on 10 occasions, out of those 10, if you listen to your heart on 7 occasions, if you, you know, sort of make peace with your reality and the lives all of us have EMIs to pay on those 3 occasions, no problem. I'll go with that. I think the real challenge is not to cook up something which doesn't exist. I think the biggest disservice, the biggest mistrust which we can create, whether as PR people or journalists or whatever, I think is to cook up something which doesn't exist. And that is why my real concern, frankly, comes from these new age broadcasting platforms which have given so much power in the hands of individuals. And, you know, if I'm not a responsible person, if I get drunk here, and if I feel like, you know, saying something really nasty and bitchy about some high-profile person, and I use that platform, and because it's me and because it comes from me, somebody actually believes it, that this may well have happened, and it leads to a story, and over a period of time it becomes a fact, I think that will be the biggest disservice, the biggest mistrust that we would have created as far as our viewers and our own selves is concerned. So we need to figure out, are we willing to only and only restrict ourselves to facts? Short answer is yes, we must. Do we? I'm not really sure.
Yeah, but at the bottom line, we have to, if we are in the show business, all of us are, by the way, in the show business, we have to glamorize facts to an extent. What is the thin line? Where does one need to stop? And at how much does the audience decide is a question which remains up in the air as we speak. Thank you all. Thank you, Sharif. Thank you, Vibha. Thank you, Puja. And thank you, sorry. Thank you, Bhupendra.
Thank you to you for being a wonderful moderator and host.
Thank you, Katie, and we will not let you go before we request, of course, may I request Chairman from Aviva to hand over a token of appreciation on behalf of the Exchange for Media Group for this wonderful panel here. Of course, we're talking about the fact that, yes, everybody has to pay their EMIs, but like Bhupen said, 7 out of those 10 times, if you listen to your heart as an agency head, as a journalist, as a communicator, stating facts and not deviating, and for the rest of the three, you can look after, I guess, paying your EMIs, I guess. That should also do the trick. With a loud round of applause for this wonderful panel here, Bhupen, Pooja, Vibha, Sharif, and of course, Kumardeep, for having moderated this particular session.